Reading greetings from St. Paul's in Crescent City. Though I asked permission to come here before I decided to come here, and they most graciously said fine. I'm not sure they weren't maybe a little happy to get rid of me for my Sunday. So, let's look at these readings today, and what do they really say to us? They are very familiar readings, so we tend not really hear what we are saying. Look at Moses, and look at what the Lord did in that reading. What was the Lord responding to? He was responding to the cries of his people. And his people were in slavery in Egypt. They had originally gone there, and one of the sons of Israel, Joseph, taught the Pharaoh how to make grain silos so they could get through a famine. But then, of course, after the Pharaoh learned how to accumulate things and get power from it, therefore, he just kept right on accumulating. And so they did for the 400 years between Joseph and Moses. And so there was a issue of productivity. Any of you have a job? We all don't have jobs. I remember when I was still working at a real job that I heard that word a lot, productivity. One person said it was the longest four-letter word in the English language. And so what Pharaoh was doing was saying, I want more. So, you know, these Hebrew children with whom he would not associate, you know, they didn't eat with the Hebrews. They were too dirty for the clean Egyptians to eat with. Does that sound familiar? And then they were considered to be aliens. And they were getting too powerful. There were going to be too many of them. There were almost as many of these aliens in the land as there were Egyptians in the land. So I won't draw the parallels for you. If you can't see it, you'll get it anyway. So he said, well, make them gather their own straw. And then he saw them sleeping in the early evening. He said, wake up, put them back to work. We need more, more, more. The more he got, the more he wanted. He was incredibly, unusually wealthy. He had an income in his day which was like some of the CEOs had in our day. And he couldn't get enough and wanted more. And the life of the Hebrew children didn't stay the same, but it kept getting worse and worse and worse. So this story of Moses is a kind of an amusing story if you think about it. Moses walks by and sees a burning bush, and then he makes this statement, oh my, I should set aside, stop and look at this one. Now if that had been me, I think I probably would have jumped up and nearly fainted, and probably some four-letter words would have come out of my mouth. And because of what's going on here. But then he realized that what he was doing is encountering the Holy. And what happened, and that's what always happens when we encounter the Holy. The Holy said, my people are suffering, and you need to go and do something about it. And then the whining begins. Well, I can't do that. Who am I doing out there? And who are you, by the way? And then God gives you this answer. I am that I am. I am who I am. If one translator translates it as, I am being itself. It's the very nature of the universe, the very underlying ground of the universe or Fox News or CNN, none of which actually give you the news. They all give you a story that they're trying to sell. But they don't tell you any of the good news. They just give you all the bad parts that's going on. So how are we, when we live in such a world, to be better than Peter, who clearly wished Jesus to repay evil with evil? He clearly wished Jesus to rise up and be the Christ. Christ meant king to them. He clearly meant for Jesus to, you know, kick some Roman butt and throw them out and make Israel the empire. So how do we do this better than Peter? Can we be expected to be better at following Jesus than Peter was? Even the lawgiver Moses, you know, they figured out it was God who hid his face because he was afraid to die. And then he goes, who am I that I should go to the Pharaoh? Well, we all feel that way, don't we? Who am I? All of us always think of somebody else to do. Somebody who's smarter than me, somebody who's stronger than me, somebody who doesn't have nearly all the responsibilities that I have. I looked up on your website, and there's a list of the ministries that go on here in this church. And they're more than one page. These are all the things that you do here. And I look at the calendar, and I'm sorry, it's full. So how are you going to do anything else? And what is this wild-haired guy, wild-eyed guy going to ask us to do something more? Who am I to go to Peter? Well, Jesus tells his disciples, who are no doubt by now quaking in their boots or in their sandals, that he's going to have to go be handed over, he's going to be tortured, and he's going to die. This is a guy that they all thought was going to lead them out, like the great Moses led the Israelites out. And he says to them, it's probably not for now, those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Does anybody here want to lose their life today? Well, how would your life stop? Anybody want to change anything? Do something different today than you did yesterday? Okay, I'll remember that. So, if you look at the epistle today, Paul clearly outlines what it's like, what it should be like to be a community of Christians, an assembly of God, is what the Greeks says. So, there's a lifestyle described there. And it's not the same lifestyle as prescribed by the empire that we live in now. It's a lifestyle of giving and sharing and taking care of the needy. And this is not a lifestyle you get just by joining the church. It's not a lifestyle you get by just showing up. In fact, some of the people who are following the teachings of Christ the best never come to church. I always like a quote that Gandhi said. He said, they asked him what he thought about Christians, and he said, well, I don't have any trouble with Jesus, but I'm not sure about Christians. So, it's always been difficult, because, you know, this letter to the Romans, which was the last thing written by Paul, even though it's the first in the canon. It's the last thing written that we have. He was clearly dealing with a congregation that he thought he needed to tell and do more than they're doing, or doing differently than they're doing. Otherwise, he wouldn't have had to have written something so passionately and obviously passionately. See, they were struggling not to be squeezed into the mold of the empire. They were struggling not to be squeezed into the mold of the religious elite of their days. Remember how the other Jewish Christians wanted the Gentile Christians? genuine love for that. I'm not talking about being polite to each other, although that's a good idea. He's talking about really caring for each other, being there for each other, holding fast to what is good. That tells me he wants them to look at what is good in their culture. There's a lot of good things in Fortuna's culture. And there's some things that aren't so good in Fortuna's culture. So he said, hold fast to what is good. Have mutual affection, heart and spirit. Serve the Lord. It's kind of a shame I revisited. You will love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your strength, and all your soul. So serve the Lord. Have hope. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the saints. See, you know, they were preachers for pity and not reaching out for money 2,100 years ago. That's what he was talking about. And then he says, extend hospitality to strangers. So those are the ways to not be overcome by evil. Those are the ways that we can overcome evil by God, by good. Now I'll tell you some stories. I'm trying to keep track of my time so I don't put it in all of you to sleep. There's an organization, you've got a handout with a little brief description of it there, and my phone number. It's called True North, and it's a division, a regional organization consisting of Humboldt County and Delaware County, and it's a division of a national organization called People Improving Communities by Organizing, PICO. There's a lot of Episcopalians all over the country that have recommended this organization. So it's safe. So I'm going to tell you some stories about what's already happened. In Delaware County, there's a young girl, 14 years old. She's a mom. She's a beautiful young girl. And her friend, who's a 16-year-old boy, Native American boy, and they and some other kids, some teenagers, were asked, what is the problem in this community? Where is there pain in this community? Where does change need to happen? And they, when they were asked this, fresh in their minds, was the death of 4 teenage children in a car wreck that had happened because these children had stolen something like 12 bottles of alcohol out of the Safeway. Now, you walk in the door, one of the doors at Safeway, where no checkers were, and right ahead of you was the alcohol aisle. So these kids were routinely walking in, stealing the alcohol. Sometimes they'd go back to the bathroom and drink a bunch of it and put some out the window. They were stealing. One boy reported that he stole 12 gallons of alcohol one afternoon. So, teenage drinking is a big problem everywhere. It's even a bigger problem in Crescent City, where there's nothing for these kids to do. And so they inebriate themselves in one way or another. So this young girl and this young man, when they were asked, and several others asked, what they thought the problems were, what were they worried about? They were worried about alcohol use among their peers. So, with the leadership, the coaching of a local community organizer by the name of Melissa, who's been doing this for about 15 years, they went first to the manager of the Safeway store, and they asked him if he would agree to do what he could do to restrict the access of alcohol to kids. And so he agreed to put theft caps on the bottles, to close that aisle from 2 a.m. until 9 a.m. in the morning. Nobody needs to buy booze at 2 o'clock in the morning, etc. except if you're a teenager looking for something to do, and you have seen being intoxicated, aggrandized on TV. He agreed to put a lock on the bathroom, so you have to go get the key to go back and use the bathroom. And they agreed to, at dark, shut the one door so that kids who came in trying to steal the alcohol, they'd have to go out the door where the chapters were. And then they went to the sheriff's office, and the police department, and the board of supervisors, and drew their attention so that now when someone at Safeway says somebody's stealing alcohol, the police are there within about 2 minutes. And so they got this manager out of Safeway and had him commit to all these things in public, which he was happy to do. So that was a success story. It was done by organizing people to achieve what they thought they needed, and by going to what the values are in that community. Just caring for children. Another example, fish were dying, the salmon were dying on the Klamath River. And the Yurok and the Karuk and the Hupa were a little bit upset about this. So there is an organization going on through True North on the tribal lands too. So we, in about 24 hours, got a bunch of signatures of people that were involved in True North and sent it to the water board, asking them to please consider this. So they got that the next day, and the next day they went up the river on boats with Native Americans. And the next day, they agreed to release the water so that the fish wouldn't die. Now, of course, they said, well, we were going to do that anyway. I don't believe that. But so those are just two examples. I'll give you one more. This one happened a little over a year ago in McKinleyville. Again, we asked people in the community what they felt needed to change, what was the problem. And the one that came up, we asked about 350 people. And the one that came to the top, the one that was most on their minds, was public safety. Because people that were on skateboards and wheelchairs and bicycles, think about that, those populations. Those are the marginalized folk in our society. Those are the dirty Israelites in our society, in our country. So they decided what they needed on Central Avenue were the sidewalks that actually connected with each other. They were contiguous, and that they didn't have lots of bumps and breaks, and that they were